ISIS Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of Hearts of Stone, written by Simon Scarrow, read by Jonathan Keeble. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by ISIS Publishing Limited. Prologue. Lefkas, September 1938. The shutter clicked, and Karl Müller lowered the camera and smiled at the three teenagers, two boys and a girl sitting on the bench. He coughed and spoke to them in Greek.
That's it. All done.
As he packed his Leica away in its leather case, the three teenagers stood up and crossed to the table where the latest findings from the archaeological dig had been placed. A student from Berlin was the only assistant still working with Müller. The rest had already packed up and returned home after the summons from the head of the department at the university. Not only this expedition, but the two others on the Ionian Islands, and as far as Müller knew, every other archaeology team around the Mediterranean, had been ordered to abandon their work and return home. All thanks to the deteriorating international situation. Müller had delayed for as long as possible, and had finally given in after the last telegram from Berlin ordering him to do as he was told or face the consequences. As he recalled the telegram, he looked anxiously at his son. Peter was tall for a boy of 16 and could easily be mistaken for someone a few years older. He had yet to build muscle on his slender frame and, as a result, looked somewhat fragile. The glasses he wore only seemed to emphasize that. Müller sighed briefly. His son was all that he had in the world following the death of his wife several years earlier. He was afraid for the boy. Peter was staring in fascination at the latest discoveries uncovered on the site. In a better world, he would be free to follow the dictates of his heart and his father's interests in archaeology. But the world was as it was, dominated by the hard-hearted credos of powerful rulers and their henchmen. They threatened war, and if they got their wish, then Peter would be drawn into its perilous embrace. Müller had seen service on the Western Front in the first great struggle of the present century, and could not forget its horrors. He prayed that his boy, and millions of others, would not have to share the same fate as the previous generation. The girl had approached him shyly and was watching Müller as he packed his camera away. He turned to her with a warm smile.
What can I do for you, Eleni?
Herr Dr. Müller.
She addressed him by his German title before continuing haltingly in the German taught to her by Peter.
The picture you took, is it possible? May I have a copy for myself?
He nodded.
Of course. I will see to it when I get back to Lefkada and develop the film.
Eleni Theskoudis smiled brilliantly, white teeth contrasting with the olive tone of her skin and the long dark hair that framed her oval face with its brown eyes. A pretty girl, he thought to himself. He could understand why Peter had developed feelings for her. It was obvious the boy was smitten, even if he refused to admit it to his father, denying it in the adamant, embarrassed way that teenagers do.
Thank you, Dr. Müller. You are most kind.
And you know how to charm men to do your bidding, eh?
He teased. And she gave a shy smile and shook her head before turning away to join her friends leaning over the nearest table. Peter was pointing at a shard of pottery, still carrying its delicately curved handle, and was explaining some detail to Andreas, the sun glinting off his glasses each time he looked up at the Greek boy. Müller turned his attention to the student sitting at the next table and cleared his throat.
Heinrich!
The student looked round, his brown hair neatly combed into place. Heinrich Steiner's shirt and shorts were stained with sweat and dust, but Müller knew that he would discard them the moment he returned to Lefkada, and change into his usual neat combination of flannel trousers and white shirt, with that wretched party pin fixed to the breast pocket. Müller approached him and stood on the opposite side of the table.
Have you finished cataloguing the day's finds?
Almost, Herr Doctor. Two more entries and it is done.
Good. Then put them away and return to the villa. When you see the foreman, tell him I want this all packed up first thing tomorrow. The finds are to go into storage in Lefkada. The same with our equipment. The student arched a brow.
We are leaving it all behind?
What else can we do? Muller shrugged. The university wants us to return at once. I'll have to try and arrange the shipment of our finds when I return to Berlin.
The student nodded and turned back to his notebook and continued filling in the details of the last items in front of him. Muller turned back to the teenagers.
You three can go with Heinrich. He'll drive you back into Lefkada. I'll follow in the car.
You're staying here? Asked Peter with a frown. But Andreas's father has invited us all to dinner tonight.
I'll be there. I would not want to disappoint Mr. Kataridis. But I have a last few things to deal with before I leave the site.
He pursed his lips and glanced round the small vale surrounded by steep hills.
Before I leave it for the last time.
You'll come back, father, once the trouble has passed.
Muller patted him on the back.
Yes, of course I will. And you, if you want to.
Peter grinned.
Try and stop me. Besides, I would miss my friends too much.
He gestured towards the other boy and girl and switched back to Greek.
My father says we will be coming back when the world has come to its senses.
Good.
Andreas flashed one of his rare smiles, then frowned briefly as the girl gave the German boy's arm an affectionate squeeze.
We will be waiting for you,
he continued in a voice laced with irony.
No doubt bored out of our wits, with no one here to explain our own history to us in such fascinating and endless detail.
Peter shook his head sadly.
I am a civilized man amongst Philistines.
Enough of your games, you young fools,
Muller interrupted, as his assistant completed his work, snapped his notebook shut, and rose from his bench.
Go with Heinrich now.
The impatience in his voice was obvious, and Peter and his friends turned away from the tables and made for the path that led out of the vale in the direction of the camp where the members of the expedition lived when they were not at the house in Lefkada rented by the university. The tents, camp beds, and stoves would all join the rest of the equipment to be stored in the warehouse to await the archaeologists' return. Muller watched them until they were out of sight, and then waited another few minutes until he heard the rattle of the truck starting up. The gears ground, the engine note rose in pitch as Heinrich eased down the accelerator, and the vehicle clattered and jolted off along the rough track. When at last the sound of the engine had died away and there was silence, Muller looked round the small valley. Nothing moved, no sign of life. Then he stirred, striding purposefully around the main excavation with its pegs and taut lengths of twine marking off each area. A section of the foundations of the large structure they had discovered lay half a meter below the surface of the ground and had been painstakingly exposed over the last 2 years. Now it was to be abandoned, left to return to nature if the great powers of Europe decided to turn on each other again. Muller left the main site and made his way through the shrubs and stunted Mediterranean oaks towards a nearby cliff. Emerging from the thin line of trees, he paused and glanced round, listening, to be sure that he was quite alone. Satisfied, he eased his way round a gorse bush and began to climb a narrow path that ran up the cliff. The ascent was not difficult. There were plenty of protrusions to use for foot and handholds. 5 meters up, he came to the ledge that rose at a gentle gradient towards a finger of rock standing proud of the cliff face. Unless a person was close, the rock appeared to be part of the cliff. Indeed, it was only a week before that Muller had ventured up to the cliff, looking for a vantage point to take some photos of the whole site. It was then that he had noticed the geological peculiarity and climbed higher to investigate. Breathing heavily from his exertions, Muller shuffled along the ledge until he saw the dark opening, hidden from sight behind the rock. His heart quickened with excitement as he approached. At the mouth of the cave, he felt the coolness of the space within and shivered. Catching his breath, Muller crouched low and squeezed through the gap. Inside, the light penetrated only a short distance, as no direct sunlight entered the cave. Muller pulled out the torch in his pocket and switched it on. Abruptly, a shaft of light cut through the gloom towards the rear of the cool, clammy interior. The air was musty-smelling, and Muller's boots crunched on the small stones on the floor of the cave. He felt an excitement burning in his veins that he had hardly ever felt before, and then bitter frustration. Here was the great archaeological discovery of the age, and yet he could not take advantage of it. If only there had been more time to explore the cave properly and discover all its secrets. As he had done a handful of times before, Muller slowly approached the rear of the cave, where the hewn rock gave way to a flat surface. Two columns, cut out of the mountain, flanked a great slab of stone. It was featureless, save for a short phrase engraved into its surface, the work of a mason who had passed from this earth nearly 3,000 years before, yet preserved so well it might have been the work of yesterday. Muller shone the torch at an angle so that the words would be clearly discernible. There was no mistaking the name, or the epitaph. One day, Muller vowed to himself, this discovery would make his reputation. The world would forever link his name to this place, and the treasures that rested in the darkness beyond the wall of stone. Chapter 1. November 2013, Kent.
Why'd you have to do this, miss?
Anna had been walking back towards her desk between the tables of the Year 9 class and stopped to turn towards the voice. Jamie Gould stared at her with a questioning expression. She was aware that a number of other faces had looked up from their worksheets, waiting to see how she reacted. Anna knew the class well enough to identify those characters who were disruptive rather than simply clueless. Jamie was not one of the latter. Instantly, her guard was up. Anna cleared her throat softly.
Do what exactly, Jamie?
This.
Jamie nodded at the worksheet, and his dark, wavy hair shimmered momentarily. He was an undeniably handsome boy, and Anna knew that many of the girls in the class were attracted to him, including, regrettably, Amelia Lawrence, a studious girl who would be sure to get an A star in history, provided she chose to study the subject for GCSE. Anna hoped very much that she would. She felt genuinely protective towards Amelia, in that way that female teachers did about those female students they hoped would go on to achieve a decent future for themselves, unencumbered by children and boyfriends, or, God forbid, husbands and partners like Jamie Gould.
The worksheet is part of the assessment process, Jamie,
Anna replied patiently.
You need to complete the tasks so that I know how much you have learned about the topic.
But it's boring, miss.
Anna smiled.
There's no guarantee that everything you learn in school will be entertaining. Some of it is merely important. I'm sure you'd understand that if you gave your full attention to the subject, Jamie.
There was a beat, and she saw the hostile gleam in his eyes and instantly regretted her put-down. Anna despised those teachers who derive satisfaction from slapping down their students, as if there was the smallest kind of achievement in humiliating a younger, less educated and experienced human being. And yet she had just indulged in the same practice, almost instinctively. There was no excuse for it, she admonished herself.
Why should I pay attention, miss?
Jamie set his biro down with a sharp tap and leaned back in his seat, stretching out his legs.
History's boring. There's no point to it. Why make us do it? We ain't like there's any use for it once I leave this dump.
And that day can't come a moment too soon, my dear Jamie.
Anna approached the table Jamie shared with five others, carefully selected to surround him with positive role models, as if their work ethic might somehow be viral. She kept her expression neutral as she met his defiant gaze, hurriedly trying to decide how to deal with this latest assault on her authority.
My, what a lot of issues you have raised. Where should I begin?
Well, you should know, miss. You're the history teacher.
Jamie glanced round as some of the class laughed nervously, and others regarded the confrontation with curiosity. Anna saw Amelia's lips flicker in a smile as she regarded Jamie. That smile, small, thoughtless gesture that it was, wounded Anna, and she turned back to the boy with a cold expression.
Yes, I'm the teacher, and it is my job to try and teach you, for your sake. What do you want to be when you leave here, Jamie?
I want to do something interesting, something well paid, not like being a teacher.
He paused.
That's boring.
I see. Boring, is it?
There were so many responses, desperate to find expression. The first, and most necessary to hold in check, was to tell the arrogant teenager that, on current form, he would leave the school with a clutch of poor qualifications that would be little more than attendance certificates, and let him see how far he got with that during the present recession. Then there was the urge to explain what education was all about, how important it was for Jamie, for everyone, how it underpinned everything that made civilized life possible. Anna decided it would be best to restrict herself to a more narrow argument.
You say history is boring.
Boring,
he nodded.
Well, it's just stuff that's happened long ago. We can't change it. It means nothing to me, nothing to anyone around now. We shouldn't have to waste time on this rubbish.
He stabbed a finger at his worksheet, where Anna could see that his answers amounted to little more than a handful of words, begrudgingly scrawled in the spaces provided. A scribbled-out doodle extended down one margin. Anna's gaze flicked up to fix on the boy's eyes, and she saw there the peculiar hostility towards female teachers that she had seen in many boys in the 5 years she had been teaching. She tried to ignore it as she framed her reply.
I find it impossible to share your opinion, Jamie. For me, history is not boring at all.
Far from it.
History is like a great story, and it explains everything. It tells us why things are the way they are.
That's why it's important, to all of us. Even you, Jamie. It's my job to try and make you see that.
You can't make me.
He clicked his tongue.
You can't make me do what you want. And if I don't want to do history, then you've no right to make me. Why can't I learn some proper stuff? Stuff that's going to help me find a real job.
There was a dangerous glint in his eye now, and he leaned forwards as his voice rose.
What's all this about?
He picked up the worksheet and waved it in front of Anna.
A load of crap questions about some bridge that fell down in Great Yarmouth over 100 years ago. What's the point of it?
Anna felt her heart beating faster, and the familiar sick feeling swirling in the pit of her stomach as the boy challenged her. In truth, she shared his dislike of the worksheets with their tired old evaluations of primary and secondary evidence. But that was what the head of humanities at the school insisted on using. It was depressing to watch students working through coloured folders differentiated by ability year after year. Anna tried to tailor her lessons to share some of her passion for history with her students. But for a small proportion of them, it was a challenge that would have exhausted even Sisyphus. She wanted to tell Jamie that she shared his opinion of the worksheets. She wanted to tell him about the great stories that filled the pages of history, about the characters, heroes and villains alike, who strove against each other or pursued daring courses of principle and enlightenment. To share with Jamie the powerful lessons of the past. A quote came to mind. A few lines on an index card she had pinned above her small workstation in the staff room. Those who don't study history are doomed to repeat it. Yet those who do study history are doomed to stand by helplessly while everyone else repeats it. She had put the card up to remind herself every day why she had chosen to become a teacher of the subject. One day, perhaps enough people would value history enough to break the cycle. Until then, she must contend with Jamie and those like him. A sudden movement caught her eye, and she glanced aside quickly enough to see Lucy, a heavily made-up blonde girl, gesturing towards the clock above the whiteboard and making a winding motion with her hand. Jamie had seen it too, and then noticed that his teacher had shared it as well, and he gave a thin smile of defiance. So that was it, Anna thought to herself. The familiar game of engaging the teacher to waste time until the bell rang at the end of the lesson. She felt cross at herself for falling for the ruse. She slowly drew a deep breath. It was all part of the give and take of the profession. It would balance out in the round, she told herself. There would be better lessons, where Jamie would simply content himself with being bored rather than disruptive, or, better still, content himself with yet another unauthorized absence. She leaned forward and spoke in a calm voice.
Jamie, there is no getting out of this, so you might as well make the most of it. Finish the worksheet, and don't disrupt the lesson any further. Understand?
Even as she spoke, Anna mentally winced at the admission he had extracted from her. He had disrupted the lesson. That was his prize, his fruitless reward in his ongoing struggle against an authority that would grind him down in the end. And now the little idiot was grinning. Turning away from his table, Anna made her way back to her desk at the front of the class and glanced at the clock.
10 minutes left. I don't want any more talking. Just finish the worksheet. Those of you who complete it can hand it in at the end of the lesson. The rest will get to finish it for homework, and let me have it first thing tomorrow. Get on with it.
For a moment, Jamie did nothing but stare defiantly back at her. Then he shrugged and picked up his biro and began to make small circular motions. Anna considered confronting him again and insisting that he do as he had been told, but realized it would only mean a renewed disruption to the lesson and even less work being done by the rest of the class. It was with relief that she responded to the shrill ring of the school bell announcing lunch break. Before she could utter a word, there was the customary shuffling as the students reached for their bags and began to put their stationery away.
Finished sheets on my desk. I expect the rest first thing tomorrow, in my pigeonhole.
Anna had to raise her voice as chairs scraped across the worn vinyl floor and shoes and bags clattered against the metal legs of the tables. Jamie and most of the others made for the door. Only a handful headed for Anna's desk and hurriedly placed their work in a rough pile to one side of the class register. Amelia was the last to leave, and she flashed a quick smile as she handed in her sheet, each answer box filled in neatly and fully. There was something about her smile that told of the embarrassment she felt for her teacher, and Anna nodded her head subtly to share the brief moment of understanding. Then Amelia was gone, and Anna was alone in the classroom. She wondered why so many school kids found it difficult to share her passion for history. It was hard enough battling a system that seemed intent on marginalizing the subject in favor of relevant skill sets. It was even worse when politicians used history as an opportunity to ram home some patriotic ideology, or to raise awareness of whatever contemporary social issue vexed the more progressive members of Parliament. Sometimes it seemed that there was no love of history for its own sake. Anna opened her eyes and stood up, sweeping together the thin sheath of completed worksheets, and paused. There was a sheet of paper still on the table where Jamie had been sitting. With a sigh, she crossed the classroom and picked it up. A series of ink swirls surrounded two lines written diagonally across the sheet.
History should be fucking history.
Anna shook her head, then considered reporting this to the head teacher for him to take further action against Jamie.
What's the point?
Anna asked herself quietly. She tucked the sheet under the others in her hand and turned to leave the classroom and make her way down the corridor to the staff room. When she opened the door, the scene was as familiar to Anna as the living room of the small terraced house she rented. More so, in many respects. The same people were sitting in the same chairs, opening their plastic tubs and taking out their sandwiches, fruit and crisps. The sharp tang of filter coffee wafted from the short stretch of kitchen counter where the staff stacked their mugs. A few faces looked up and nodded a brief greeting. Anna made for the doorway, leading through to the narrow room lined with work cubicles. She had been allocated one as a newly qualified teacher when she first came to the school, but no one had thought to reallocate it, and now Anna regarded it as her spot. She placed the worksheets on the shelf above the cluttered desk space and sat down. The school's IT technician had replaced the usual screensaver with a cozy animated fireplace surrounded by holly and Christmas stockings, with a digital clock on the mantel counting down the seconds to the end of term. The image vanished as Anna flicked the mouse, and then moved the cursor over to the login box and tapped in her email address and password, and the folder containing her applications appeared. She moved the cursor onto Facebook and double-tapped. The familiar blue masthead appeared with the drop-down timeline, and she quickly scrolled down the news feed. There was the usual round of personal updates, adverts and offers to join games or take part in a quiz. Anna read them without interest, and then turned her attention to the three red icons at the top. Two friends of friends wanted to be accepted. She hit the Not Now button and moved on to the messages. There was one new item from someone named Dieter Müller, not a name she recognized, and she opened it with a mild sense of curiosity. Is this the Facebook account of Anna Theskoudis, daughter of Marita Theskoudis, granddaughter of Eleni Carson, née Theskoudis? Anna was surprised. She did not know anyone called Dieter Müller, and she felt uneasy that he seemed to know something about her family. Her fingers hovered above the keyboard and then tapped out a quick reply. Who wants to know? And why? Chapter 2. Once the reply was sent, Anna switched to the BBC News website and glanced over the headlines before she went back into the main staff room and made herself a coffee. Strong, black and sweet, just as her mother had always made it, the Greek way. Returning to her workspace, Anna set her cup down and went back to Facebook. There was another message from Dieter Müller. I meant no offense, just trying to track down a lead concerning a thesis I am preparing here in Munich. I should introduce myself. I am a German research student studying the expeditions to the Ionian Islands that took place before the Second World War. I am looking for descendants of a Greek family who lived on Lefkas at the time. I came across the name of Eleni Theskoudis, who came to England shortly after the war as the wife of a British officer. Is Eleni your grandmother? Anna read the message again, more slowly. She was innately suspicious of Facebook, having seen how it was routinely abused by students to play tricks on each other and occasionally bully. Not even the staff were immune from such acts, and she wondered if this was anything to do with Jamie. Better to be careful, she reflected, as she composed a response. I don't know you, and I'm not in the habit of giving away personal details to strangers on Facebook. If you are for real, then send me your email and proof that you are who you say you are. She sat back and clicked her tongue. It was brusque, to the point of rudeness, but despite wanting to know more about how this person who claimed to be German knew about her family, Anna was not going to be lured into some pathetic student prank, or worse, some kind of scam. She typed again. How did you find my name? She saw a prompt indicating that the stranger was typing, then one word came up in the message box. Google. Bloody Google, she muttered. Is nothing private anymore. More words appeared in the box. Google led me to genealogy records, and I guessed you might be on Facebook. Tried your name, and so... Are you the person I am looking for? If not, my apologies. If so, then you might help me with some small details about your family's history in Lefkas. That's all. You might find my research of interest. Anna raised an eyebrow thoughtfully. Her grandmother's family owned a small supermarket in Nidri. She had met them a handful of times when some distant cousins of her mother had visited England to see Eleni, and she had been there just the once for a wedding 2 years ago. They seemed to be a typical Greek family, loud, proud, and warm-hearted, at least as far as any blood relative was concerned. Beyond the immediate family, there seemed to be a number of ongoing feuds whose causes were so ancient that no one recalled what the original grievance was. Quite unremarkable, Anna decided. So why were they of interest to Dieter Müller? He had found her through Google, and two could play at that game. She switched to the search engine and typed in his name, together with Munich University, and the list of references appeared. There were over 300 hits, but luckily only 7 that combined the name and the institution. She clicked the first likely link, and the page of the archaeology department came up, with the option to view the contents in English. Another click and a short delay, and there was a page listing alphabetically the graduate students and their research project outlines. Anna scrolled down until she saw the name and opened the entry. A fresh page appeared with a small portrait image of a young man who appeared to be her own age. His hair was short and dark, and he wore rimless glasses above a neatly trimmed beard. There was an attempt at a smile, to save himself from looking like a passport picture, and Anna noticed a small red star stud in his ear. His expression was gentle enough, she decided, certainly not threatening or unsettling. She turned her attention to his research statement, and the translation was clear enough to get a grasp of his field of study. Sure enough, Müller was examining the program of excavations carried out by German archaeologists on Ithaca and Lefkas in the years before the outbreak of the Second World War.
All right then, Dieter, she said under her breath. You seem to check out.
She typed a fresh message.
What can I do for you?
Reply.
I would wish to interview Eleni Theskoudis, if that is possible. Also, I would be interested to examine any photographs, diaries, or other records of the era that I might be permitted to see.
Anna typed,
You don't want much, then. My grandmother is in her 90s.
Reply,
I understand. But may I ask, is she sound of mind?
Anna had to smile. She had seen her grandmother only a month before on a visit to her mother's home in Norwich, and Eleni's mind had been as pin-sharp as ever, even if her body was stick-thin and she only ventured to the post office once a week to claim her war widow's pension. Yes, she was of sound mind, and sharp-tongued, too. Anna smiled as she recalled Eleni addressing her sternly, telling her that she should get on and marry someone. Life was too short, she insisted, stabbing her bony finger as she spoke with a pronounced Greek accent. Eleni was compos mentis, all right. But that was not the true difficulty in any interview that the German student might have in mind. Anna reached for the keyboard again.
My grandmother is sound of mind, but I doubt she would be interested. From what she has told me of her youth in Greece, I suspect that she would not take kindly to a German asking her to relive it. I don't think I can help you.
Reply.
I am sorry to hear that, but think it over, please. If Eleni is unwilling to grant an interview, then perhaps I could interview your mother or yourself concerning what you or she may know. I am in London next month. Could we meet and discuss this? I could explain my project in more detail. I am sure it would interest you.
Anna shook her head. Despite the politely formal tone of his request, she knew next to nothing about this Dieter Müller. But something made her hesitate. It would be interesting to know more about her grandmother's background. Then she glanced up and saw the worksheets that needed marking. There were 25 minutes of lunch break left. If she worked quickly, they could be dealt with, and she would not have to take work home. Her fingers tapped quickly.
Sorry, can't help you.
Then, feeling that such a brusque dismissal was a poor-spirited response to the German student, she added a few more words.
I'm sure it is a very interesting project, but I have no time to spare to help you right now. Good luck with your research, Dieter.
There was a short pause, and then the message, Dieter is typing, appeared in the message box. Reply.
I understand. If you change your mind, then I give you my email. DieterMuller3487@hotmail.com. Let me know. Best wishes, Dieter.
For a moment, Anna felt tempted to continue the exchange and offer one last message, but then she glanced at the worksheets again and made herself close down the Facebook screen and log off from the computer. She pushed the keyboard back towards the flat-screen monitor, slid the paper in front of her, and reached for a green pen to begin marking the first worksheet. As she worked through the student's responses, Anna could not put aside the messages from the German, and wondered precisely what it was about her grandmother that had provoked him to track her down. It had to be something significant, something important, something that Anna felt that she needed to know for herself. Chapter 3. Anna woke early the next morning. She blinked her eyes open and automatically glanced at the clock on the bedside table. The dull yellow display told her that it was only 6:15, still half an hour before the alarm went off. The heating had not yet come on, and there was a bite to the air in the room, so she wriggled down a little further under the duvet. Anna recalled that there was still a new scheme of work for Year 7 that needed completing. Steeling herself, she slid out of the bed. Pulling on a pair of tracksuit bottoms and her dressing gown, Anna slipped her feet into her slippers and padded across the landing to the small second bedroom that she used as a study and sat down at the desk. She had left her notes out in front of her computer keyboard the previous night so that they would not be overlooked, and now reached for a pen. Then she paused, staring at the blank monitor as she rolled the pen slowly between her thumb and forefinger. She set it down and tapped the keyboard. At once, the computer stirred from its sleep mode, as it whirred from beneath the desk, and after a few moments, the monitor flicked into life. Anna logged into Facebook and opened the exchange of messages between herself and Dieter Müller. She read through them once again, and then reflected on the prospect of finding out something about her family's history. There were times when she felt that the subject she taught neglected the history of the vast majority of people. Untold numbers of remarkable experiences had been lost forever because ordinary people were overlooked and their memories went unrecorded. Perhaps she could do her bit to resist that process. She might discover something about the experiences of her grandmother during the Second World War. A story that would be worth recording and handing down to succeeding generations. Maybe it was even something she could use to inspire her students, to make them realize that everyone plays a part in the making of history. Even though she had the German's email address, Anna decided not to use it. She wasn't ready to establish that line of communication yet. Better to use Facebook messaging. So she leaned forward and typed, "I apologize if I seemed rude yesterday, but your approach was a bit out of the blue, as we say here. Now that I've had a chance to think it over, I would like to know more about your project. If you have any free time during your visit to London, we could meet for a drink or a meal. I finish teaching on the 16th, so any time between then and the 23rd of December would be good for me. Let me know if that suits you." She sent the message and then stared at the screen for a few moments, but there was no sign that any reply was being prepared. With a sigh, Anna picked up her pen again and returned to her work, keeping half an eye on the screen. There was no response by the time she had finished the scheme of work. In contrast to the swift exchange of messages on the first day that the German had got in touch, there was no reply from him that day, or the following week, nor the week after that. She felt disappointed at first, then gradually it began to slip her mind as the term dragged on towards Christmas. Besides, she felt it beneath her dignity to send any follow-up message and decided that he must have given up on her, that it was just one of those brief flurries of communication that typified the social media. Anna resolved to forget the matter entirely and concentrate on school life. Classes came and went. Jamie Gould was interviewed by the head of year about his poor attitude, and the school's big musical production careered towards the grand opening night, when the hall filled with dutiful parents and members of staff coerced into attending. After joining in the applause and then lingering to speak to some of the parents, Anna went to collect her belongings and head home. The staff room was empty, and she hurried through to the workroom to pick up her bag and the coat hanging over the back of the chair. The computer was still on, and she went to close it down, hesitated, and logged into Facebook. There was a message waiting for her, from Dieter Müller. She quickly clicked on it. "Apologies for the delay in replying to your message. I have been in Greece doing research. I am delighted to hear you will see me. Next week I am in London. Can meet you for lunch on Tuesday. I will pay, of course. Shall we say 1 o'clock at Le Grand Restaurant on Baker Street? Let me know if this is possible soonest. Thank you and best wishes. Anna sat still for a moment, then reached for the keyboard and typed quickly,
All right, I'll be there.
The streets of London were packed when Anna stepped out of Charing Cross Station a few days later. To the left, the usual crowd of sightseers visiting Trafalgar Square milled around street performers. The Christmas lights hung across the traffic like a latticework of stars glinting in the frosty air. The schools had broken up the previous Friday, and hordes of children accompanied their parents as they bought the last of their presents. Anna was genuinely curious to discover why Dieter had said she would be interested in his research project. If it could shed some light on her grandmother's past, then it would be worthwhile. Eleni rarely spoke about her childhood to Anna, and mentioned little of what she had experienced during the war. Anna had asked her mother the reason for this reticence, but she knew only the bare details from relatives from that side of the family. The Greeks had suffered greatly from the German and Italian occupation of their country. In Athens alone, over 300,000 people had starved to death. Conditions had not been much better in the countryside. Although there was more food to go around, the bitter conflict between the partisans, the Andartes, and the fascists had led to reprisals in which tens of thousands of Greeks had been shot out of hand and their villages razed to the ground. Eleni had been brought up on the Ionian island of Lefkas, which, as far as Anna knew, had suffered least under the occupation. Perhaps Dieter Müller would be able to tell her something about that, as well as the period he was investigating, the years before the war, when his countrymen had been more interested in digging up the past than crushing those who lived in the present. As soon as the comparison had entered her mind, Anna felt a twinge of guilt. Remembering the war seemed to be something of a national obsession in Britain. The endless documentaries on television, the reruns of Dad's Army, Allo Allo, and Goodnight Sweetheart, and the shelves of Waterstones heaving with books about the war. Not to mention all the computer games she occasionally heard the boys talking about at school, and the childish headlines and images in the tabloid newspapers every time the England football team played Germany. It was over 70 years ago that the war had begun, yet it had lingered first as an open wound in the minds of those who had endured it, then an object of fascination for the following generations, and finally, entertainment. Anna knew that it was different in Germany. She had been to Berlin on a school trip and seen for herself the shrines to their national sense of guilt, the Holocaust Memorial and the museum detailing with appalling frankness the murderous barbarity of the Gestapo and the SS. Sometimes the burden of the past weighed heavily on Anna and reminded her why she had become a history teacher. There was a duty to remember, to learn from the past, if only to better understand the present. And yet in Britain, there was an alarming tendency to trivialize the catastrophe that had ripped the heart out of the middle of the 20th century and still scarred the dwindling numbers of those who had lived through it. Her thoughts preoccupied her so much that she'd already turned off Oxford Street and was heading north to Baker Street before she was aware of it. Glancing at her watch, she saw that it had just gone 12:30 and nodded with satisfaction. She would reach the restaurant first and try to identify Dieter before he saw her. She had the advantage of knowing what he looked like and would get a first impression before they introduced themselves. It was an old habit that went back to her first dates, when she wanted to see the boys as they were before they put on the mask they hoped to impress her with. Mind you, she reflected, it was more than likely he would recognize her too. There was so little privacy these days, thanks to the internet. But this was hardly a date, she reminded herself. Just a quick meeting with someone who wanted to share some information that might shed a light on her family history. Something interesting. That was all there was to it. She found the restaurant a short distance down the street. It had a small entrance with a large window to the side. A pair of printed linen curtains framed a display of baskets containing bread, onions, cheese, and hams, with a large green jar of wine set to the side. Beyond the window, Anna could see tables stretching back inside the restaurant, most of which had been taken by diners. That was good, she decided. Much less chance of standing out when Dieter arrived. Anna pushed open the door and entered. She was confronted by a bar at the end of a long counter. A dark-shirted woman with blonde hair looked up from the till and smiled a greeting.
Can I help?
Yes, I believe a table has been booked by Mr. Muller. I'm joining him for lunch.
The waitress glanced down at the sheet beside the till and nodded.
Please follow me.
She led Anna towards the rear of the restaurant, between two lines of tables, and her heart gave a little skip as she saw a man looking up from a table where he sat alone. Dieter had reached the restaurant first and had been there some time, judging by the notebooks in front of him and a near-empty glass of wine. Hurriedly closing his notebooks and shoving them in a small rucksack beside his chair, the German rose to his feet and offered his hand as Anna approached.
Thank you for coming, Miss Thescudis.
He spoke her name slowly and carefully, in an accent that sounded vaguely American as much as German.
That is right, Thescudis. I was not certain. Your mother is called Hardy Thescudis, and your grandmother is Mrs. Carson, I believe?
Yes.
Anna smiled. When my grandfather died, she reverted to her Greek name, as did my mother, until she married and took my father's name as well. At least until they divorced. I changed mine to Thescudis after he left us. The German blinked.
I see.
Anna laughed as she shook his hand, noting that it was warm to the touch and that he wore three ornate silver rings, the kind of jewelry she associated with art students.
I think you'd better stick with Anna. Much easier to deal with.
Yes, I think so, he grinned. And you call me Dieter, please.
He gestured to the high-backed chair on the other side of the table, and the waitress reached out.
Can I take your coat?
Anna nodded and slipped it off, and then sat down and made herself comfortable as Dieter resumed his seat. He raised an eyebrow inquiringly.
A drink before we start?
A glass of dry white wine, thank you.
The same for me,
Dieter added. The waitress turned away, and there was a brief, awkward silence before Anna smiled.
You look a little different to your photo on the university website.
Oh? How so?
Your hair is a little longer, and there was a stud.
He self-consciously reached up to the yin-yang symbol hanging from his right lobe and then shrugged.
The university prefers the graduate students to look professional for the public.
Anna could not help a chuckle.
Same with my school. You think from our handbook that every child came to school in a spotless new blazer and was permanently ecstatic at the prospect of another day's education.
He considered this for a moment and pursed his lips.
The ecstasy is optional in German educational institutions.
Then, realizing what he had said, he laughed.
I mean to say, the happiness, not the drug.
I guessed.
Anna felt herself warm to him, and the initial strain of the introduction abated a little. She folded her hands on the table.
So, you're studying for a doctorate in history?
It was a clumsy attempt to steer him towards the purpose of his meeting, and Anna winced inwardly as he replied,
Archaeology, rather than history.
A similar discipline, I would have thought.
He looked surprised for a moment and tilted his head to one side.
I suppose the link is close enough. There are many routes to understanding the past. You have an interest in history?
I teach it, at school. The Ashthorpe Victory Academy.
An academy? This sounds impressive.
Less so if you understood our education system. Basically, it's a rebranded comprehensive school. No big deal. But I love teaching my subject. So yes, I have a professional interest in history.
Good. Very good. Then we share an interest in the past. So I'd better tell you why I have asked to meet you.
Anna smiled encouragingly. Dieter sat back and collected his thoughts.
I am not the first archaeologist in my family. My great-grandfather was the first, a noted man in the field, back in the 1930s. He was one of the best students of Professor Dupfeld,
He spoke the name as if Anna should have heard of it.
He, in turn, was an admirer of Schliemann, who discovered Troy. Like Schliemann, the professor was a passionate reader of Homer, and he wanted to continue Schliemann's work. Well, no, he wanted to achieve something greater. He wanted to find the palace and tomb of Odysseus, the hero of Homer's second great work. You know the Odyssey?
I've read some of it when I was at school.
Then you'll know that after the war with Troy was over, Odysseus wandered for many years before he returned to his kingdom of Ithaca. At least that is the story the Homer tells. In truth, his return was probably without so much incident. He and his men came back from the war, their ships laden with spoils from Troy, treasures that he would have kept in his palace. That was what Dürpfeld believed, and he led an expedition to Ithaca to search for the remains of the palace of Odysseus. He and his followers, my great-grandfather amongst them, searched Ithaca for years, finding few ancient remains, never anything large enough to be the palace of a king. So he considered the possibility that the ancient sources might not provide enough information. Ithaca is a small island. If it had a king, then it is possible that his realm extended to other islands nearby. So my great-grandfather, Karl Müller, was sent to carry out excavations on Lefkas, while another colleague searched on Kefalonia.
Dieter raised his hands.
It was, as the phrase goes, a long shot, but Karl accepted the challenge.
I think maybe he hoped he would find something that would make his own reputation. I have his diaries of those years. His diaries, his notebooks, and his photographs.
And did he discover anything?
Dieter hesitated an instant.
Not really. No. Just the remains of a large building. There was never enough evidence to identify it as the palace of Odysseus.
Oh.
Anna could not hide her disappointment. What a shame.
So what's your interest? Do you hope to continue where he left off?
The German smiled.
Nothing like that, no. There's barely any trace left of the excavations, just fragments. My interest is more ethnographic. I want to provide an account of the relationship between my great-grandfather's team and the local people at the time. My research is a comparative study between invasive and sympathetic archaeological methodology with respect to indigenous populations.
Anna nodded slowly, and Dieter caught her expression and laughed.
It is really much less complicated than it sounds.
I should hope so.
The waitress brought their wine on a tray and set the glasses down. They waited until she had walked away before Dieter resumed.
So, I have my great-grandfather's records, and what I need is the other side of the story. The memories of those Greeks who worked alongside him at the excavations on Lefkas. Well, that's where your grandmother enters the story.
Eleni? How? She was only a young girl at the time. I've never heard anything about her being involved in any excavation.
But she was there. She is mentioned in the diaries. Eleni Thescudis. There are several references to her being present. She was a friend of my grandfather, Peter, who was also there on the island, accompanying his father.
What proof do you have that it was her, my grandmother?
I have checked the records in Lefkada. I have traced her to England. That is how I found your mother's name also. And yours.
He reached down into his rucksack and pulled out an iPad.
Look, I will show you.
He swept his fingers over the glass surface and then turned the device towards her to reveal a black-and-white image. Anna leaned closer and saw that it was a scan of an old photograph. Three teenagers, two boys and a girl, arms on each other's shoulders, sitting on a bench in front of several long tables piled with fragments of pottery and pieces of stone, some of which looked to have been sculpted. Beyond lay a patch of open ground dotted with shrubs and trees, before the slope of a hill rose up in the distance. The boy on the left of the picture was darkly featured with wavy hair, a solid build and wearing long trousers and boots. To his side was a girl, also dark-haired, with similar Greek features, and to her right sat a taller boy, blonde-haired and wearing glasses. All three were smiling and were clearly friends. She looked more closely at the girl and gave a slight start.
That's her. That's Eleni.
She raised her eyes and saw that Dieter was smiling at her.
Your grandmother. You see, I was right about her.
Anna tentatively touched the screen with her fingertips and spread the tips apart to enlarge the image for a closer look at her grandmother. The grain of the image increased, but it was still clear enough to identify Eleni from the similarity to a handful of pictures that Anna had seen when she had visited the house Eleni had lived in before she moved in with Anna's mother. In fact, she had a vague feeling that she had seen this particular picture before and strained her memory to try and place it. Questions tumbled through her mind.
Who are the others? Where is this? And who took the picture?
One at a time, please.
Dieter edged back from her intent gaze. Anna took a breath to calm herself and let him continue. Dieter pointed to the taller boy.
That is my grandfather, Peter Müller. He was 16 at the time. Your grandmother was a year younger. The other boy, Andreas Kataridis, was the oldest, 17. They were friends of Peter from Lefkada. That's where the expedition rented a house while they conducted the search for the palace of Odysseus. Your grandmother was the daughter of the town's police inspector, and Andreas the son of a poet who had come to live on the island. Spyridon Kataridis. He came from a wealthy family in Athens, but eloped with one of the servants. They had a child, Andreas, but his mother died giving birth to him. The family were angry and disowned Kataridis, all except an uncle, who sent him a comfortable allowance to live on and raise his son. As to who took the picture, that was my great-grandfather. He took it at the site of the main excavation on the island. Here, I'll show you some more.
Dieter flicked his finger across the screen, and Anna saw more black-and-white images, some of which showed the landscapes of the island, some the inhabitants, roughly dressed peasants, townspeople, fishermen, some images of ruins, and then a handful of pictures of German soldiers wearing mountain caps with a white flower pinned to the side. One picture caught her eye.
Wait,
Anna intervened.
Isn't that him? Your grandfather? Go back one. There.
He stood, one boot braced on a rock, striking a pose, hands on hips. His jacket was unbuttoned, revealing a white collarless shirt beneath. At his feet was a backpack and a belt, attached to which was a leather pistol holster. Behind his glasses, he was squinting into bright sunlight, but his face was largely unaltered, slightly more filled out, perhaps, Anna mused.
Is this during the war?
Dieter nodded.
After he joins the army. His father was forced to leave the island when the German authorities ordered him to return home and abandon the excavation. That was in 1938. He had hopes the crisis would pass and that he would resume his work. He never did. He was killed during an air raid in 1943.
Anna felt uncomfortable and muttered,
I'm sorry.
Don't be. It was nothing to do with you. It was a war. Anyway, my grandfather, like nearly all young men, was conscripted. He was selected for officer training and served with an artillery regiment. That picture was taken in Greece, Lefkas, actually. He was posted there for a while to act as an interpreter.
Anna's eyes widened.
He returned to the island. Well, did he meet Eleni and...
She thought back a moment.
And Andreas again.
Dieter seemed to wince, then smiled sadly and gave a single nod.
That must have been difficult for all of them. They had become enemies, though they did not wish it.
Dieter stared at the image of his grandfather.
It was a terrible time for Greek and German alike. My grandfather's diaries do not make for easy reading. He never spoke about the war to me or my father. I knew nothing of his record until after he died and I went through his papers and the Wehrmacht archives.
He flicked back through the images to the first one.
This is how I prefer to remember him. And in his diary he says it was when he was happiest. I would like to find out more about that time,
even though, strictly speaking, my research is more concerned with the earlier period. And that is why I would like to interview your grandmother, to see what she remembers of the excavations, particularly where this picture was taken. I have tried to locate it when they explored the island, but so far no luck. He turned the iPad off and returned it to his bag before he addressed Anna again. I would ask you to talk to your grandmother and see if she will let me speak with her. Anna pursed her lips.
I'll ask. But I must tell you that she still looks back on the war in a very unforgiving way.
I understand. But I am not my grandfather. My generation looks back on that time in horror and shame for the stain it left on the reputation of Germany. Please explain that to her. My great-grandfather was the same. He despised the National Socialists, and he loved Lefkas and the people, and most of all the history of Greece. If anything, it is his reputation that I wish to restore when I finish my thesis. He could have become one of the greatest archaeologists of his age, or any other time. I believe he was on the verge of great discoveries. If he had only lived long enough to return to his work on the island.
Dieter suddenly gave a shamefaced smile.
I am sorry. It is a burden for me. I should not impose it on you. I have asked enough of you already. Now,
he sat back and picked up the menu.
We shall eat. You are my guest. Our business is over. We shall talk of other things over the meal, unless you wish to ask me more.
Anna laughed, touched by his sweet politeness.
Perhaps. Let us see.
She raised her wine glass.
How about a toast?
Dieter smiled and raised his glass.
To what?
She thought a moment.
To healing old wounds and uncovering the past.
Chapter 4. The following weekend, Anna took the train up to Norwich to see her mother and grandmother. The heavy leaden skies of the day before had cleared, and the morning was bright and clear, with a chilly bite that presaged the arrival of winter. She felt a certain lightness to her spirit with the fine weather and the prospect of seeing her family again. As the train raced through the East Anglian countryside, Anna put on her headphones to listen to her iPod. She smiled as she came across the Johnny Cash playlist. Her mother was a big fan, and by default that made Anna familiar with the most popular tracks. She listened with delight as the deep, gravelly voice rekindled memories of her childhood spent in the kitchen, as her mother cheerfully accompanied her hero while she prepared the evening meal. Like so many families where Greek traditions stuck hard, there was a pride in preparing food rather than reheating ready meals, and Anna could almost smell the rich aromas of the family kitchen. Often Eleni had been there too, gossiping with her daughter in a mixture of accented English and native Greek, some of which Anna could follow. As she listened to the music, her thoughts returned to the meeting with Dieter and his revelations, which had thrown a small light on her grandmother's past and inspired Anna to want to know more. It would have to be handled sensitively, she told herself. Eleni was an old woman, a frail woman, though her spirit was strong. Anna did not want to upset her. There was little chance of Eleni agreeing to be interviewed by Dieter, but Anna was keen to discover her story herself. She would decide later how much of it she was prepared to share with the German research student. It was nearly midday when she reached Norwich and took a taxi from the station to the road where her mother lived, an avenue lined with semi-detached houses dating back to the 1930s. It was close to the university, and many of the houses were owned by academics or rented by students, who had always made interesting neighbours when Anna had been a teenager going out at nights for the first time. Now she felt a warm sense of remembered belonging as the taxi pulled up outside her mother's house. She sat for a moment looking up the short path to the front door with its leaded glass panel, small coloured panes arranged in a floral pattern, and smiled. Home. That's how it felt. Even now, 8 years after she had left for university.
The doorbell still didn't work, and she instinctively reached for the brass knocker and rapped twice. A figure appeared beyond the glass, misshapen, moving quickly. With a metallic rattle, the door opened, and her mother beamed, then embraced her tightly, kissing her on both cheeks.
"Anna, my dear, so good to see you again. And you, Mum."
She could only lift one arm to return the embrace, as the other hand was holding her overnight bag, and in any case, her arm was pinned to her side.
Come in out of the cold. I'll put the kettle on."
Anna followed her inside, and the door clicked shut behind them. The house had a long entrance hall with a staircase rising to the left. On the other side was a lounge, dining room, and a large kitchen at the rear. The dining room had been given over to Eleni, and was her bedroom, on the same floor as the small bathroom beyond the hall and back door at the rear of the kitchen. Anna nodded down the hall and spoke in an undertone.
"How is she? All the same as ever."
They shared a smile before Anna's mother took her bag and made for the stairs.
"Go and say hello. I'll put this in your room. It's rented to a student, but she's away until after the new year."
Although the room had been rented out when Anna had got her teaching job, she still affected a pained expression.
"It's only been 8 years, and already you've replaced me with a stranger. That hurts." "It's a bedroom, not a shrine, my girl, and I need the income. Teacher's pay being what it is. Now go and see your grandmother."
As her mother climbed the stairs, Anna stared after her, noticing there were more grey streaks in the hair tied up in a bun. But her figure was still as slim as ever, something she took care over with regular visits to the gym at the university's sports centre. She had taken early retirement from teaching the year before and commenced a part-time master's degree to give a focus to her life. Then, as her mother passed out of sight on the landing, Anna approached the dining room door and knocked lightly on the dark stained wood. A reedy voice called out,
"Come in, girl! Come in!"
Anna turned the handle and entered. The room had been sparsely furnished when it had been a dining room. That had been her mother's taste in decor. But now Eleni's stamp was on every aspect. A bed sat in one corner with a crocheted coverlet spread neatly over the top blanket. There was a small walnut table beside the bed with a pink fabric lampshade atop a carved wooden stand. There was a bookshelf filled with books, mostly in Greek, a sewing box, long since abandoned as age took its toll on her joints, but kept all the same. Two armchairs were either side of a side table by the window which overlooked the small garden at the rear of the house and was framed by long velvet curtains. A large patterned carpet covered most of the wooden floor, and a mock wood-burner fan heater sat in the fireplace, beneath a mantel laden with framed family pictures. There was a stale smell in the room, a reminder of the days when she had smoked before her daughter had told her to stop and refused to buy any more cigarettes for her. Eleni was standing in the middle of the room, one hand clutched about the handle of her walking stick, while the other was extended towards Anna. Her hair, once long and jet black, was now a dirty-looking grey and shoulder-length, tied back to reveal the heavily lined skin stretched over her skull. She wore a navy cardigan over a white blouse and a long dark skirt and thick stockings that disappeared into a fluffy pair of slippers. Her thin lips parted in a smile.
"Anna!"
There was a breathless coarseness to her voice that came from many years of smoking.
"My dear Anna."
Anna crossed the room and took the old lady's hand, feeling the tremor in the stick-like fingers. Eleni gave a quick squeeze and presented her cheek for a kiss, which Anna gave willingly before she stood back half a pace to look over her grandmother.
"How are you feeling?"
"Feeling? I am feeling as an old woman should, stiff and delicate. What do you think someone of my age feels, huh?"
Anna smiled.
"As up for it as ever. Good for you, Yaya."
"Up what? Never mind. Come, we go to the kitchen. Your mother prepares coffee for us."
She released Anna's hand and tapped her ear.
"It's still good."
She paced slowly across to the door with the aid of her stick. Anna went to help her, supporting her arm, but the old lady shook her off at once with a brisk jolt of her shoulder, and Anna raised her hands in mock resignation. They made their way through to the kitchen, where a long counter extended against one wall, with a gas cooker dominating the center. At the other side of the room was a large wooden table surrounded by chairs with leather backs. It was a warm room, and light flooded in through the tall sash window beside the table. Anna's mother rejoined them as Eleni eased herself onto the chair at the head of the table. She rested her stick against the wall and settled down, straight-backed and imperious as her dark eyes looked over her granddaughter.
Are you eating well, Anna? You look thin.
I'm eating properly, Yaya.
Psh!
Eleni turned to her daughter.
Look at her, Marita. Thin as a rake. You need to find a good man and settle down and eat properly.
There's a few things I want to do before I do that, said Anna. Quite a few things, actually.
Well, we all say that, my dear.
Eleni leaned forward a fraction.
You should get married.
Anna had become used to such comments, and had endured them with regard to the two previous serious boyfriends she had brought to the house. She returned her grandmother's smile indulgently.
I will marry when I'm ready to marry, if I decide to marry at all, that is.
The old woman wafted a hand dismissively.
Young people think they will live forever. That is their tragedy.
And old people think that they have lived forever,
Anna replied.
That is theirs.
Eleni stared at her for a moment, and then her face creased as she cackled.
You have your mother's spirit, and mine. That's the Greek in you.
Speaking of which...
Marita nodded towards the cafetiere.
The usual? Or are you still drinking that instant crap you started buying at university? The usual, please.
Marita poured a generous amount of dark grains into the filter, topped up the reservoir and flicked the switch on. Soon the powerful aroma of coffee filled the kitchen, adding to Anna's sense of well-being.
So, what's the reason for the unexpected visit?
Marita asked. Anna thought quickly. She was wary of telling her about Dieter Müller and his research in front of Eleni. It might be better not to mention him. Not straight away, at least.
I wanted a chance to see you both before Christmas. That's nice. So will you be spending it with us?
Of course.
There was a beat. Then Anna cleared her throat.
Also, I wanted to talk to Yaya about a history project I'm involved with.
Eleni raised her thin eyebrows.
Talk to me? About what?
When you were growing up. On Lefkas.
That was a long time ago.
But you remember it?
Of course.
Eleni wagged a finger.
I am old, not stupid.
I didn't think that for a moment. I wouldn't dare, Yaya. Would you be happy to talk to me about it?
Happy? I think yes, for the most part.
Good. Then let's have coffee and we can talk.
Anna turned to her mother.
If that's okay with you.
No problem.
I need to go out to buy a few things for dinner. Thanks.
Anna took her hand and her grandmother's.
I can't tell you how good it feels to be home again.
Anna closed the door behind her mother and returned to the dining room, where Eleni was already settled in her armchair beside the window. Even though it was the middle of the afternoon, the sun had already dipped below the roofline of the houses backing onto their garden, and the room was bisected horizontally by the glow of the sun high up on the walls, while the rest was in shadow. The room felt cool, and Anna gestured towards the fan heater.
Would you like that on?
Eleni nodded.
I feel the cold more and more.
The heater hummed in the background as they faced each other, each side of the low table. Anna was not certain how to begin the conversation. There was a short silence before Eleni spoke.
You want to know about my childhood? You have not asked me about it before. Why now?
I never felt comfortable about it. Mother said that times were difficult and that it would only upset you.
Marita worries too much. I am old. All I have is memories. If I do not use them, then what is left to me? It is true that the old times were difficult, but it was not always so. Before the fascists came, life was good. We did not live as comfortably as you do, but we had enough to make us happy.
Your father was a police inspector, I think.
Eleni nodded.
A fine man, strong, and respected by all. But you know this.
Mother told me, but not much else. For example, I never knew if you had any friends.
I played with the other children in my school. I counted some as friends.
And were there any others after you left school?
Eleni hesitated.
A few. Why do you ask me this?
Anna chewed her lip and then took out her mobile phone.
I think it's simpler if I show you something.
She tapped the screen and then, warily, rose from her chair and knelt down beside her grandmother, offering her the device.
I can't see this,
the old woman complained.
I need my glasses. Over there, by the bed.
Anna fetched them, and her grandmother fumbled to get them on, balancing the middle over the bridge of her long nose. She picked up the phone again and stared at the screen, and gave a sharp gasp.
Where did you get this?
It's a picture someone sent me, an historian. He said it would be of interest.
That's you, isn't it, Yaya?
She watched the rigid expression on the old woman's face, and then saw the corners of her mouth begin to tremble.
How is this possible?
Eleni demanded quietly.
How? Tell me.
As I said, it was sent to me.
Eleni stared at the image and then thrust the phone back towards her granddaughter.
No, it's a trick. Who would do a thing like this?
She was trembling now, and Anna felt alarmed by her reaction.
It's just a picture of you with two friends. That's what I was told.
Eleni closed her eyes tightly for a moment, and her wrinkled hands balled into fists.
Yaya. Yaya, are you all right?
Tears pricked out at the corners of the old woman's eyes, and Anna felt a stab of fear and compassion.
What is it? Tell me. What's the matter?
Eleni wept in silence, and Anna took one of her hands and eased her thumb into the palm and rubbed soothingly.
I'm sorry. So sorry. I shouldn't have shown you that.
She was angry with herself, angry with Dieter Müller for sharing the picture with her and bringing this all about in the first place.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
At length, Eleni swallowed and raised her spare hand to dab away the tears before she opened her eyes, and Anna could clearly see the pain there. Eleni pointed to the bookcase.
Over there, top shelf. You see the large brown book? There at the back.
Anna glanced round and nodded.
Bring it to me, girl.
Anna straightened up and did as she was told, easing the dusty volume from the bookcase. The leather cover was cracked and flaking away in places, and Anna held it carefully as she carried it back to her grandmother and set it down on the table. Eleni leaned forward and tentatively stretched out her hands to touch the cover and stroke her fingertips over it. Then, with a little nod to herself, she eased the cover open and began to carefully leaf through the thin card pages. There were letters, photos, and a few pressed flowers. At one time, they had been stuck down, but over the years, many items had come loose, and she had to take care to prevent any slipping free of the book. At length, she turned another page, and there lay the same picture that Dieter had shown Anna 2 days before. It was an original photograph, not a scanned image.
I've seen this album before, said Anna. I remember some of the other things, as well as this picture.
Eleni nodded.
You picked it up once in my house, many years before. You were five at the time. Too young to know what it means to me, but young enough to be interested. So I did not mind then.
She tapped a finger on the picture.
I did not know there was a copy of this picture.
She fixed her granddaughter with a piercing stare.
There is only one way. There could be another. Karl Müller took this, but he is long dead. So, his son?
Peter?
Anna saw her grandmother shudder at the mention of his name.
No, not him. His grandson, Dieter, sent me the copy on my phone.
You know him?
Eleni hissed.
He is here, in England?
No, no. At least I don't think he is in London at the moment. He said that he had to return to Germany to continue his research.
Anna explained hurriedly.
He wants to know about the island before the fascists came, back when the Germans were digging for ancient ruins. It has nothing to do with the war, Yaya, I promise.
He is a German. He promises me nothing.
Eleni grasped her hand tightly.
You will not see him again. You will not speak to him, understand?
The intensity of her expression and sudden strength of her grip frightened Anna.
But why? Tell me why.
Eleni released her hand and sagged back into the armchair. She was silent a moment, and Anna could see the pulse in her throat flickering like a candle in a draught. Then she sighed and spoke again in a calm voice.
The Greek boy at my side in the picture is Andreas Katharidis,
my close friend.
She smiled thinly.
Then, yes, but more, much more later on. The other boy was also a friend, Peter Muller.
She paused and her voice hardened.
That was before he came back to the island to murder us, became our enemy. How can these things be?
She closed her eyes as she remembered.
I try to remember that it was not always so. There was a time before. Before the great evil came to our little island.
Chapter 5. Lefkas, September 1938. The camera shutter clicked, and the three teenagers relaxed from the pose they had struck and held while Peter's father set the exposure and adjusted the focus. Karl Muller looked up and smiled at them.
That's it. All done.
As he lowered his Leica and reached for the camera case, Peter glanced at his friends and raised an eyebrow.
Sorry. My father's something of a photography addict.
Eleni laughed, parting her thin lips to reveal white teeth and a smile that Peter considered faultless, even though there was a noticeable gap in the top incisors. She shook her head.
Don't apologize. That's all you seem to do about your father. He's a nice man.
Even for a German?
Especially for a German.
She nodded discreetly towards the young man sitting at the end of a long table, laden with bits of pottery, small stones, and other fragments that might hold some archaeological value.
Unlike our friend over there.
Peter glanced round.
Heinrich.
He watched his father's assistant carefully entering an item into the log.
He knows his job and works hard.
Eleni sighed.
He's a cold one. I don't trust him.
Andreas stared at her side, his dark brows knitting together.
Oh, he has offended you? No, not like that. I just don't like him much. He had better not upset you when I'm around.
She touched his arm briefly.
You are not my brother, nor my cousin.
No. He relaxed his expression. Just a friend.
Exactly. And I can look after myself.
Andreas smiled.
Of course you can, little Eleni. You're 15. Almost a woman.
She glared at him in jest, and Andreas laughed. Peter joined in, a little pinprick of pain in his heart when her eyes lingered on Andreas just a moment longer than was necessary.
Come on, he said. Let's see what they've found today.
He stepped out towards the table and the others followed. Peter visited the site most days, but his friends came less frequently. They'd become friends after Andreas's father had invited the German archaeologists to a dinner at his villa. Shyly at first, but quickly becoming close, as youngsters will on a small island. The Germans had been digging in the small valley for over 18 months, and interest in their painstaking methods had soon palled, and the local people turned back to their routines. The most recent finds were at the end of the table where Heinrich sat on a camp stool. He delicately held up a fragment of fine pottery and closely scrutinized it for a moment before lowering it and entering several words in the comments section of the log. Peter waited until he had set his pen down again.
Anything interesting?
Heinrich shrugged and gestured towards the scattered shards before him.
Wann ist der Mann unerst sieß?
He responded in German.
He broke it with the first stroke of his trowel. So times I've warned them to go in gently. So now we have a little reconstruction work to do. Or would have, if we hadn't been recalled. Have to wait until we return.
Peter was conscious that his friends could not easily follow the exchange, despite his teaching them some German over the last few months, and switched back into Greek.
How old do you think it is?
Heinrich grinned at him and the others.
Late Mycenaean, 3,000 years old, and it's a fine piece. Look here.
He picked up one of the larger pieces and held it up for them to see. A row of delicately painted warriors, hoplites, ranged along the curve of the shard.
I'd bet that this came from a wealthy household. Perhaps these are the remains of a nobleman's house, or maybe that of a king. Either way, it's more evidence that your father is on the right track.
Eleni edged forward and examined the small figures, marveling at the brightness of the colors.
3,000 years old.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.